Hey guys, it's Carly with Builds by Carly. We're here in the Smoky Mountains of Tennessee, and we are at the most challenging lot we have ever taken on. So today we're here with Nick Klein of American Excavating, and he's gonna go over what it takes to work a lot like this. So Nick, tell me what your honest thoughts are when I first showed you this beast of a lot that we are going to be building on next.
So when we first started talking about this lot, my first impression was find a different lot. This one has been a challenge. We started with the machine in the road to start digging a bank that stopped at the edge of the road with a 20-foot cut to 17-foot cut at the beginning, leading, 100 feet to the cabin with a 11-foot cut up there. We've been trucking dirt out for weeks with 60 loads of dirt hauled out so far because there's obviously nowhere to put it. We're right on the side of the mountain road here.
Would it be safe to say that this is one of the most challenging lots you've ever taken on also?
It's definitely been a challenge. It's for sure been a challenge, but it's not the steepest one for sure because...
Oh, wow.
Well, the lot itself is the steepest lot probably that we've worked on, but we're making it less steep with the road that we're putting in. It's definitely a challenging lot for sure.
So for anybody who doesn't know how you start a lot like this, it's always really important to have a surveyor involved. Any good surveyor can actually stake the lot and where the cut should be made to maintain the slope that you need for zoning regulations. You always have to comply with your zoning regulations. There is a max slope allowable here, and we needed to make sure we could meet that with the existing topography of this lot. So the surveyor does the staking, and then this is where Nick comes in, and him and his guys do the hard work. I mean, this was all up at that height. So how did you get it to what we're standing in now?
So we started back here where the slope began at the edge of the road and pretty much filled half of this road full of dirt and instantly started hauling dirt out. So we've been doing a lot of hauling. That's the biggest key in this step of the project right now is haul out all this material because there's nowhere else to put it.
And when you have rocks this size, you're doing all of your hammering, your drilling to break this up. How do you control that?
So what we do is we'll start with this pad that we began with, that we started hauling the dirt out with, and all that rock that breaks off falls into this little pit that we've made and slope back into the bank. So anything that comes down lands in our catch basin, and then from there we'll use it for erosion control to keep the dirt from washing out into the road as bad, or we'll use it up here for fill or truck it out if we have to.
So we've had an engineer out here to look at this, make sure that we're keeping everything stable as we go along, because the idea is we do want to make sure this is safe.
So from here, we've got some more trees to clear out, and I don't think we're even on grade yet here. So this bank has to go back more. The top has to be laid back a little further. This is still going down and going around that rock there. We're gonna have to put the hammer back on and break that out and get the driveway up the hill a little bit more.
And then how do you know when you're at roughly the right grade?
So the surveyor puts out a benchmark for us to start with, and then we start from that benchmark, and then on the site plan, so many feet from that benchmark is a proposed grade that we'll go with.
Okay.
So then it's up to us to do our math from that benchmark. So when it comes to that, it's pretty easy. It's the rocks the problem.
Yeah.
It's all measurements and laser levels. That's all it consists of. So, and the help of the engineer and surveyor, of course.
What's left to finish this out and make it the driveway that this tiny house is going to need?
So we've got to get to 25% in the driveway. So we've got to take out some more rock here to widen this and make it a little more safe. And all the rest of that fill will be trucked out. And this that we're standing on is probably within 12 inches of grade, somewhere in this vicinity.
Okay.
It's getting real close, probably another 5 days. So this here, this rock has got to come out, and the driveway's got to go further back, but all of this rock will come down into the driveway here. We'll use it for erosion control.
Which rock here gave you the hardest time?
So this is probably the hardest part, hence why we went around it. It's because the top of that rock is probably 20 to 22 feet from the bottom of where we're standing.
This is a little more of a comparison.
Well, here's your 6'6" comparison to the top of that rock up there. So when we go to take that out, we'll start at the top, but we'll build this driveway up so that that rock's not traveling and rolling as far to hit the ground, because if that happens, it could potentially roll over.
Yeah.
And take out a car or a house or anything down the mountain. We definitely don't want that.
Props to you for not running away from this one. All right, well, let's take a look at the turnaround area up here. So where we're standing now is next to the housey and in what's going to be the turnaround. So you saw a little bit of the work that's already been done, but this is what it looks like before it's touched. So we've got a couple orange stakes that are left here from the surveyor that help determine the exact placement of where the driveway is coming in and where the turnaround will be. So we will be turning this into a turnaround. And then behind me here is our house seat. This is our Lily Model tiny house, in case anybody's wondering. And it will have a window wall that faces straight ahead, 180 degree mountain view. So stay tuned for that. But this is where the house will actually sit. It's going to be our treehouse model. So it's gonna have the treehouse foundation, which means it's going to be entirely on piers, which works better with a slope like this. So Nick, why don't you tell us how you're gonna make all of this beauty happen here?
So that stake there at the base of that tree gets cut down 11 feet to reach our finished grade. And then the stake over here on your right gets filled 7.5 feet to reach that same elevation. So we'll take a lot of this fill, cut it from here, and use it here for this fill to bring up 7.5 feet to reach our final elevation for the turnaround.
And then the engineer, we're thinking we're gonna have a wing wall to support that with the turnaround, right?
We're probably going to have to, because of the critical slope of the lot. We're gonna have to have something to retain that dirt, the 7.5 feet fill. If it was only 3 or 4 feet of fill, we could probably work with it with some of these rocks that we've got to use for erosion control, but we're definitely gonna have to do a little something there with 7 feet of fill.
If you go over 4 feet, you have to have an engineer involved no matter what when it comes to a wing wall over 4 feet. So that kind of touches on what Nick said, that if we're nearing that 3 to 4 feet, we're gonna end up in the realm of using an engineer to design the wing wall, and then Nick would do the installation of it.
So in this case, we'll see what happens as we start cutting and filling, and if we can change the grade of the driveway to avoid the wall, we're always about that, try to save extra cost for sure.
A lot of times you don't know exactly every last detail on slopes like this until you're working it.
Yeah, even though the site plans say one thing, a lot of the times it'll say in bold letters or off to the side to verify in the field, because there's so much change within 10 feet of a lot like this, especially with the critical slope.
Depending on how we're going about the piers is going to affect how he and his guys lay the rebar in the footer when he digs it. And then he will be installing the rebar according to what the engineer wants to see, in addition to, of course, local building code. That is a step that does get inspected. He's keeping in mind on my footers,
right,
that these are small footprint houses, and then that is going to affect the size of your footer.
You'll probably have a foundation 3 foot wide, 12 inches thick concrete, 16 inches thick concrete, and then your piers from there, uprights through the piers, and whatever dimension on the piers that you want to go, and whatever height we decide to go with, of course.
Well, Nick, we want to thank you for coming out, sharing all the valuable knowledge, and as usual, thank you for all of your hard work on all of our builds.
Absolutely. It's always a pleasure working with you.
Awesome. We appreciate that.
Yeah, awesome.
If you liked this content, we are going to be releasing tons of behind-the-scenes construction footage and explaining what's going on here to get the houses from dirt to done. In addition, we time-lapse all of our tiny house builds, so you can see the entire project, 6 months worth of work in roughly 2 minutes. And then, of course, every time we finish a tiny house build, we do a full interior and exterior property tour. So if you like this content, like, share, and subscribe.
Awesome. Thank you, Carly.
Thanks, Nick.